Welcome to the Crazy Hat Chemist. So today we're doing another video here on periodicity, the last one of this unit. And I got a great hat for you here at the end, so hold on. Bam! So photoelectron spectroscopy, or PES for short. I'm going to give you a bunch of information and then a bunch of examples. So here we go. It's an experimental process to determine the relative energy of electrons in atoms by measuring the kinetic energy of ejected electrons. The y-axis, that is the y-axis, indicates the peak sizes, and this is intensity of those peaks. Or these are proportional to the numbers of electrons in an orbital. Okay, the x-axis is the binding energy. It's typically in megajoules, that's MJs, okay? And that's typically high energies are on the left-hand side and zero is on the right-hand side, but you need to be very careful about looking at that x-axis, okay? All right, large binding energies indicate stronger attraction to the nucleus like interior electrons, whereas lower binding energies are seen with outer electrons like valence electrons. This is another application of Coulomb's law. It keeps on popping out throughout chemistry. Okay, and let's do a bunch of examples. So you always need a periodic table with you when you're doing a photoelectron spectroscopy or a PES diagram. So the first thing we're going to do is we're going to look at this graphic here. The y-axis is relative number of electrons. The x-axis is energy in megajoules there. And on the far left-hand side of that x-axis, I got 10, and on the far right-hand side, I got 0. I got this single peak right here, and this single peak is 1.31 megajoules. And this is corresponding to hydrogen, which has a 1s1 electron. Notice that I've highlighted this height of this peak as 1, because there's a 1 electron in that orbital type. Okay, all right, let's do the next element. The next element here is helium, and that is a 1s2. Now notice the height of this one. I've kept the same dashed yellow line that I had before for hydrogen, and this dashed yellow line for this peak is twice that of the hydrogen peak. Therefore, how many electrons are in here? 2. And I should see that my number for the megajoules has actually changed from a 1-something to now 2.37, okay? So this is a height of 2 relative to those 2 electrons here, okay, in helium. Hopefully that makes sense. That's why that peak is twice as high, because there are 2 electrons in the 1s2 orbital, okay? All right, so 2.37, look at that number. We're going to go to the next element here. Notice that there's a shift to the left in terms of energy, indicating the stronger attraction of the electrons to the nucleus. I mentioned that with that 2.37 already. That's higher in energy. That's a shift to the left towards the 10 megajoules, a shifting away from the zero. Okay, let's do the next element here. The next element is lithium, which has an electron configuration of 1s2, 2s1. Okay, now I've shown the height in the peaks here, and you should see a single peak at 0.52 megajoules, and then a double peak at 6.26 megajoules. Okay, and you should look at that electron configuration and correspond the height of that peak, that 6.26, as the 1s2. You should see that shift more towards the higher energy compared to helium. And you should see that lithium 2s1 electron at 0.52 is far to the right. Okay, that's a height of 1, this is a height of 2, that has 2 electrons, and this has the 1 electron. So how many valence electrons in lithium? 1. Why is the valence electron easy to remove in lithium? Look at it. It's the 0.52 megajoules. Are you ever going to come close to removing core electrons from lithium? Not at that 6.26 megajoules, not even close. That's why lithium, or anything in group 1, has this same kind of pattern. Okay? Remember that the 1s orbital is inside that, or i.e. closer to the nucleus with the core electrons than the 2s orbital, which is outside and contains the valence electrons. This is indicated in this placement of these peaks. Okay, that is that 6.26 megajoules is closer, right? That's interior, and that 2s1 electron is farther outside. Okay, and here's a little diagram of that same thing. The yellow is indicating that 1s orbital. The orange is indicating the 2s orbital. The 2s orbital is outside. The 1s orbital is inside. And in the pink and or purple and white is the nucleus. Hopefully that color combination works for you. All right, let's keep on moving because we are not even close to being done. Our next one here. Notice that I have changed this x-axis because this x-axis changes as we proceed on with these, okay? And this is beryllium, the next element, which is 1s2, 2s2, okay? And you should notice the height of these peaks, okay? And then the next one is boron. That's 1s2, 2s2, 2p1. Notice that there's a shift in these peaks again, with the 1s2 peak now being at 19.3, the 2s peak being at 1.36, and the 2p1 peak at being 0.8. Notice that the n of 1 and the n of 2 are vastly different in their energies. This makes sense, hopefully. Okay, this photoelectron spectroscopy really truly describes so much quantitatively in terms of where the orbitals are, the energy of the orbitals, the charges of ions that are formed, okay? So you should see that there are three valence electrons here, and that is in the 2s1 and 2p orbitals, okay? Now, notice that the shells, N, are grouped together since they have similar energy levels. The distance from the nucleus, I already mentioned that, but I'm just highlighting that right there. N of 1, N of 2, and you should see that same separation as we continue on with our process. Okay, we're looking good so far. Hold on tight, because there's more. This next one is carbon. That is 1s2, 2s2, 2p2. Notice the height of all these peaks are 2. And you should see that there's a shift in energy with the 1s2 electrons being shifted closer to the nucleus. That is higher energy, harder to remove those electrons at the 28.6 megajoules. Okay, and then we have the 2s2 and the 2p2 are grouped together again because they're relatively close in energy. Okay, the next one is nitrogen, and that is 1s2, 2s2, 2p3. Again, you should see the peak of the 39.6 is the 1s2 that's a peak of 2. And then the 2s2 is a peak of 2 with 2.45. And then now we have 2p3. That's a peak there. That's a 3, and it's a 1.4. Okay, there's 5 valence electrons in that because those 5 valence electrons are grouped together in terms of their energy. All right, the next one is oxygen, and that is 1s2, 2s2, 2p4. You should see that there's a shift of everything to the left, that is towards the center of that nucleus, more difficult to remove, okay? And still, I'm grouping those 2s and 2p orbitals together, okay? We're going to shift this again to the next element, and the next element is fluorine, so we're adding another here, and that is a 2p5. That is a height of 5 there, okay? And again, that 1s2, two electrons in the 1s2 energy level keeps on shifting towards that 100, okay? All right, next one is neon. Now, we've completely filled this shell here, so we have a 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, and you should see that those peaks are corresponding to the heights of the electrons that are in here. Okay, we're gonna keep on going. We're not gonna waver from this because we got more to do. And this next one, now I want you to notice something here. There's another shift in the energy on the x-axis, and now we got 500 here because our innermost electrons, okay, are in that 104, that peak of 2, and that is the 1s2 electrons in sodium. Then the 2s2 and the 2p6 are tightly packed together, and then the 3s1 electron is kind of far away. Now notice that this is almost a logarithmic scale here, if you will, as you notice these numbers increasing dramatically. So that's why that 0.5 of the 3s1 is far away. So why is sodium in group 1? Why does sodium have one valence electron? Why does sodium form a 1 plus cation? Because that 0.5 is easy to remove. Can you remove a 3.67? Hardly. It's very unlikely. compared to 0.5. So light years of difference. Okay? So I'm noticing here that I got N of 1, N of 2, N of 3, just like I highlighted the N of 1, N of 2 before. Okay? All right. Notice that the shells and N's are grouped together since they have similar energy levels and the distance from the nucleus. That makes sense for you. All right? We're not done. We're going to keep on going. Okay? The next one is magnesium at 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, and 3s2. You should notice that 1s2 electrons, again, has been shifted over even more. Again, it continues to shift over. Okay, we're going to keep on going with this. Okay, now we got more. We got aluminum, and aluminum has how many valence electrons? Look at it, 3. And what's the predicted charge on aluminum ion? 3+. Because I want you to look at these numbers and heights very carefully, because they are very close together here. Okay, so what is the predicted charge for an aluminum ion? Okay, well, it's aluminum 3+ ion. And notice the value and energy of the outermost electrons. That is the 3p1 is a 0.58. The 3s2 is a 1.09. Those are close in energy, therefore they can be removed relatively easily compared to the next subshell, which is the 2. And you got the 7.19, no can do. Okay? All right. So that's why those are going to be easily removed electrons. That's why aluminum forms a 3+ cation, because of that reason. All right. Let's take a look at silicon, that crazy clown. Okay, and you should see that electron configuration corresponds to those heights of those peaks. There's a shift as you get closer to that nucleus. We're going to keep on going, and we got phosphorus, and again, a shift in the height of the peaks, shift in the height of those energy levels, and everything good. We're going to keep on going. We got sulfur. That height of that outermost peak is continuing to rise. We got the N of 1 together, the N's of 2 together, the N's of 3 together. Hopefully that works. We're going to keep on going. We got chlorine. Okay, the grouping is nicely together. The 1s2, the 2s, and the 2p's are grouped together. The 3s's and 3p's are grouped together. We got one more to finish this grouping out, and that is with argon, this noble gas. Now, these are relatively high, and that's why argon does not form a cation or an anion. But we're not done with this lecture yet, so don't end it. Okay, so we're going to keep on going. And what's after argon? Potassium. So we're going to keep on moving here with potassium. And so you should look at potassium's electron configuration. Notice that the 1s2, that has shifted all the way over to 347 megajoules. And then we have the 1s2 group together, the 2s and the 2p group together, then the 3s and the 3p group together, and then you have the 4s1 all by itself at 0.42. So potassium is a group 1. It will remove one electron relatively easily. That's a duh. Okay? You should see the N of 1, 2, 3, and 4. They're all grouped together. Okay? Now, you see that? Hopefully that's a good for you. All right, we're doing the next one here, which is calcium. Calcium is 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s2, 3p6, and 4s2. Okay, notice the height of that last 4s2 peak is greater than it was before. There's a slight shift, but still low in energy. Calcium is group 2. How many valence electrons in calcium? 2. Is it easy to remove those 2 valence electrons at 0.59 megajoules? Absolutely. That's why calcium forms a 2+ cation. Can you remove any of the 3s? No. Any of the 2s? No. Any of the 1s? Are you crazy? Well, I'm the crazy head chemist, but we're still not done. Okay, what is a predicted charge of calcium? I already went over this, and so hopefully you can see that you're going to remove those 2 electrons right there. That's totally easy here. Now the electron configurations and their energy levels correspond to what's on the periodic table and the charges that are predicted. So awesome. I love this. Okay, now we're going to do another one here. We got scandium. Now we're moving into the D's. Check this out. This is awesome here. So 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s1, 3p6, 3d1, 4s2, okay? So I'm going to highlight some things here for you. You got the 1s, the 2s, the 3s, and the 4s all grouped together here, okay? Now, does anybody know the charge on scandium ion? 3-plus charge, baby. Why is it a 3-plus charge? Well, look at the peak for the 4S2 and the 3D1. Look at that 3D1. It is 0.77. Now, it's greater than the 0.63, but it is interior. Look at all the threes are grouped together. Amazing, right? I think it's amazing. So the predicted charge on scandium is a 3+. And why is it a 3+? Because you can remove these three valence electrons here, or these three outermost energy level outermost electrons, okay, of the 0.77 and the 0.63 are so close together in energy compared to the 3.24, bam. Now I do understand that scandium still has two valence electrons, it's in the boot, but that's a different story. We are talking about the ion charge of scandium ion. It's a 3+. Why? Because look at those numbers. Those numbers tell all the story that there is. Okay, because the next one is in the 3Ps, and that 3P6 is a height of 6 and it has 3.24. You're not going to touch those electrons at all. Okay, that was a super cool video here, and you have finally graduated from periodicity. So stay tuned for this hat. I love this hat. I wore this hat when I graduated with my master's degree. Of course, right? It's the colors of my school, and it's a graduated cylinder. Oh yeah, baby, graduated cylinder. How about that? Give me a thumbs up if you like that video, and subscribe to my YouTube channel. Pass on the word. I love you. Have a great day. Bye now.